At first, the doctors thought it was sciatica, and then they admitted it was gangrene. The old man suffered greatly those last days. And then, on the 31st of August, 1715, the clergy gathered around him, and they began timidly to chant the Ave Maria. All through the night, they carried on chanting. And then at 8:15 in the morning, in the royal bed, in the great chamber, in the center of the palace, Louis XIV, the Sun King, died like every man. So wrote a contemporary diarist. It's often said that when Louis died, an age died with him. Not that there weren't other Louis to succeed, but the age of absolute monarchs, the age of which Versailles is a symbol, was drawing to an end. Things would never be the same again. For Louis, Versailles was intended, first of all, to be a garden. And he imagined that garden as a sort of outdoor palace built next to the one constructed in stone. And the one could not be understood without the other. And in the garden, Louis exercised the same despotism over nature that he did indoors over his court. These two tyrannies changed, softened even, over the long years of the reign. The most famous formal garden in Europe, with its rigorous geometries of terraces and staircases, its regular parterre, gave way gradually to a greater informality of trees and fields, not merely because it was so expensive to keep up, but because a new attitude to nature was developing, more sentimental, intimate, romantic.
The mood of this moment is captured in a painting done not long after Louis' death, Antoine Watteau's Departure from the Isle of Cythera. Here, a group of elegant courtiers prepares to leave the island of love. The painting signals the new attitude, more informal, poetic, and often amorous. In this paradise of Cythera, there are no restraints, and nature itself is free and unconstrained. It was a time in which the argument over nature, exemplified in the idea of the garden, was a serious debate. It was in England that this different attitude to nature arose. The informal, spontaneous, picturesque English garden was seen as an expression of English liberties. The geometric French garden was seen as a reflection of their authoritarian system of government. Thus, in the microcosm of the garden could be read beliefs about the world at large.
Here at Stourhead in Wiltshire, you can see better than anywhere in Europe the way that the early 18th century attempted to create an art of landscape by shaping nature and putting into the landscape buildings created in past styles, medieval, but especially classical. They did so in the belief that a landscape or a garden gives added pleasure if one can savor the effects of past time as one wanders around it. And that sensibility is characteristic of their period. The poet Alexander Pope said in the 1730s that this architecture or art derived from landscape painting and compared it to a picture. And that's why we call it picturesque.
And so the combination of architecture and picturesque landscape became one of the characteristics of 18th century aristocratic culture. And wealthy patrons sought architects who would design them country estates unparalleled anywhere in Europe.
This is Syon House, the seat of the Dukes of Northumberland. The 11th Duke lives there today. Doesn't look very impressive from the outside. Wait till you get in.
Robin Middleton of Columbia University, New York, has developed a highly original approach to the architecture of the 18th century.
The first design for this floor was a simple checkerboard, without these dynamic directional indicators. But all that was to change as the building took form.
The interiors here are amongst the first works of one of the most brilliant architects of the period, Robert Adam. He wanted to design just like a landscape gardener. He writes of the rise and the fall of the hills and dales, but especially of the movement between them. These effects he wanted to get when he put his masses together. These were notions of picturesque composition. He uses them outside and inside. When he uses his moldings and his patterns, he's modeling spaces and he's trying to show you how to move through them. Let me show you what I mean. Come along. Well, you won't be surprised to learn that that door leads off to the Duke's private apartments. The niche here is large, soft, intimate, well, almost. But at the other end of the hall, something very different happens. And there's a dynamic pattern on the ceiling and on the floor, which is going to lead you into that alternative direction. The niche here is hard and strong and elevated. Adam's contrived a change of levels here, which takes you up the stairs into the great staterooms beyond. The first room beyond the hall is the vestibule, a dazzling room, a riot of harsh color and gold, altogether proper for the first anteroom of one of the first peers of the realm. 12 columns give order to this room. They were said to have been found in the bed of the Tiber in Rome. They're not just elements of ostentation, though they clearly are there. Adam uses them to make an awkward room with oddly spaced window openings into a neat cube in effect. That line of columns we've just passed marks out a square. But far more interesting, Adam's used it to mark out the new axis you take from this vestibule into the sequence of staterooms which goes off from here. First, into the dining room. It was the dining room. There's a screen of columns here which gives you a moment to pause before you're thrust by the mouldings into the central space. And then you go on down the same axis into the first drawing room. Beautiful, fine room. And from that, right through to the beginning of the long gallery, which connects the private apartments and the state apartments. This is the great connecting link in the house, turning the whole circle.